Welcome to Reach Community Church at Archie's on Hog Wild Day. You believe another year's gone by? This will be our 10th year coming up next month at Archie's. And I want to give a big shout out to Miss Patty, because this wouldn't be possible if it wasn't for her. God's used her in a wonderful way, so that what started out as a small group, about 8 people, has grown and continued to grow, and God's just done so much. I'm continuously amazed. A lot of you probably wondering where Pastor Dave is. Dave is okay. He's in the hospital. Some tests are being run, and he's comfortable and well, but they're doing some more checking. So he went into the emergency room Friday evening, or in the wee hours of the morning, actually, and hopefully he will be out within a few days, but we're going to continue to pray for him. So let's open up with a word of prayer. Father God, we thank you for the opportunity to come here together to worship you, Lord, here in the fresh air on the beach, here at Archie's. We want to lift Pastor Dave up to you in prayer, Lord, and we pray for comfort and healing for Dave, and we also lift Paula up to you in prayer too, Lord. She's been there for him in all of this. And thank you, Lord, for all that you're doing for us. We pray for blessings for Miss Patty. And we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to serve you and grow in Jesus' love, in Jesus' name. Amen. Hello. First song is number 44.
Gonna get down on our knees. We give the thanks to Jesus, cause he's meeting all our needs. We're gonna gather here at Archie Sunday and lift the Lord on high. It may seem the deck is full, but there's always room for more. To squeeze and introduce yourself, cause all his friends are yours. We're gonna gather here at Archie Sunday and lift the Lord on high. Are shabby and you don't think you'll fit in, but he doesn't see the clothes you wear, he knows you from within. We're gonna gather here to Archie Sunday and lift the Lord on to Jesus, cause he's meeting all our needs. We're gonna gather here at Archie Sunday and lift the Lord on high. We're gonna gather here at Archie Sunday and lift the Lord on high.
Hey, check. The next one is Lord, I Lift Your Name on High on page 92. No, we're not doing that one.
Oh,
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us.
Number 103.
Rose and Connie.
And because he conquered the grave, Jesus is alive and well. Page 78.
Jesus is alive and well. Tell everyone you see or tell them for me that Jesus is alive and well. He's seated at the heavenly Father. He's interceding for you and me. Tell everyone you see or tell them for me. Jesus is alive and well.
Coming of the Lord is nigh. You better get your house in order. He's gonna split the eastern sky. Get the message out to the people. Let's tell it while there's time to tell. That the Son of God is coming. Hallelujah!
Jesus is alive and well. Jesus is alive and well. Jesus is alive and well. Tell everyone you see, you'll tell them for me. Jesus is alive and well. He's seated with the heavenly Father. He's interceding for you and me. Tell everyone you see, you'll tell them for me. Jesus is alive and well.
When they nailed my Jesus to that old cross, the devil danced around in glee. He thought he had the children of God, and he would take them and throw them in the fiery, fiery sea. But on the third day, the stone was rolled away. The angel said, Mary, go and tell that the Son of God is risen. Hallelujah!
Jesus is alive and well. Jesus is alive and well. Jesus is alive and well. Tell everyone you see, or tell them for me. Jesus is alive and well. He's seated at the heavenly Father. He's interceding for you and me. Tell everyone you see, or tell them for me. Jesus is alive and well. Jesus is alive and Jesus is alive and well. He's seated at the heavenly Father, interceding for you and me. Tell everyone you see, or tell them for me. Jesus is alive and well.
Let's hear it for the Archettes. Or is it Rechettes? I'm not sure yet. All right. We're continuing on in Luke chapter 10. And there are no bulletins, as you've probably discovered. They didn't get printed this week. But we'll try to muddle through it anyway. And you are welcome to take notes. All right. In Luke chapter 10, starting in verse 25, we come to a story that many of you have heard in the past, a parable called the Good Samaritan. And I actually entitled this message, Who is My Neighbor? Because that's the question that this young man asked Jesus And I don't think he asked it, as we're going to study this, out of necessarily a pure, humble motivation, as we see. He asked the question kind of trying to show his intelligence and his deep intellect and able to ponder deep questions. But Jesus just kind of ignored what we might consider character defects, because Jesus didn't focus so much on people's sin. He focused on the truth that was going to set people free, because that's what Jesus is about. He's about setting people free, not beating them up. So in verse 25, it says, "And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tested him, saying, 'Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?' And Jesus said to him, 'What is written in the law? What is your reading of it?'" See, Jesus is getting on his level here. Attorneys, what do? They interpret the law. They study the code, the legal code, and they look for little twists and curves and loopholes that they can use for the benefit of their client. So he gets on this sort of lawyerly level with this young man, and he asks him, what is your reading of it? And I like the way Jesus often answered questions with a question. And he answered, and he said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And Jesus said to him, "You have answered rightly. Do this and you will live." But the young man, wanting to justify himself, said to Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" So Jesus answers him, and he tells him, gives him this parable. And it takes our level of understanding what it means to have compassion and to care from somebody. It really breaks through that superficial level that we often have. There's so many problems and so many needs out there. And if you're in counseling, or if you're in ministry, or if you're just a caring person loving others like Jesus, which is really what ministry is, we'll find sometimes that we get irritated. We don't want to be bothered anymore. And we just want problems to go away. So there's times we just don't want to deal with it. "A certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, who stripped him of his clothing, wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead." They beat the hell out of this guy. They took everything he had, and he's helpless, out in the middle of nowhere, with nobody to help him. "Now, by chance, a certain priest came down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side." What can you say about that? The religious leader, the preacher, the pastor, the minister, the priest sees this and does nothing. Now you have to understand the culture of the time. And the Jews had taken their religion and turned it into something that was far different than from what God intended when he gave them the law. And the Israelites turned inward, it said. They turned inward. They had their people. At one time, they'd become a great nation, but they continued against God, and they lost everything, and they were under Roman occupation. But they still had the exclusionary attitude. This is our country. We don't care what happens to people over there, people that aren't, you know, from our country. And we certainly don't care about those people over there when we have to mingle with them when they come into our country, because they're not Israelites. They're not Jews. And they look down especially on the Samaritans, because the Samaritans were half-brothers to the Jews, and they considered them unclean untouchable, less than, basically they considered the Samaritans to be dogs. So this priest hardly gives a notice to this beat up, bleeding, bruised, wounded man on the side of the road. Likewise, a Levite, when he arrived at the place, came and looked. Now, a Levite, he's from the priest tribe, so he has religious connections also. And this man at least has a little curiosity. Hey, is this a dead body, or is it actually somebody living over there? And he walks over and he looks, and he does nothing. He passed by on the other side. He wanted to put some distance in between. Oh, that's a mess I would rather not get involved with. You ever been there? Somebody brings you a situation and you just don't want to get involved. You just want to put some distance in between. Kind of gives us a sense of safety, a safe, you know, we can get our minds off it quicker if we can put some distance between the issue and us. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. Jesus showed compassion in everything he did. He modeled compassion. As busy as he was, as focused as he was on the Father's mission, as focused as he was on spending time with Dad, getting to Jerusalem, teaching these 12 oftentimes immature men to become spiritual leaders and spiritual giants, and the crowds always pressing around, wanting more healing, wanting another diseased person to be healed, wanted another lame person to walk, another blind person wants to see, a bunch of people, thousands of them, need to be fed. And he took time. He took the time to do it. And the Samaritan had compassion. So he went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine, and set him on his own animal, and brought him to an inn, and took care of him. Now, undoubtedly, it doesn't take rocket science to figure out that this man probably had people to see and places to go. I mean, don't we all have busy lives? That's nothing new. But he took time, and he was willing to get involved. He was willing to get his hands dirty, bandaging him, touching him, caring for him, putting him on his own animal, and taking him somewhere where he could get further help. On the next day, oh, it says first he went, took him to an inn and took care of him. And on the next day, when he departed, he took out 2 denarii. He took out some cash, or at least his credit card. He took out his own money, and he paid the innkeeper, and he said, take care of him, and whatever you spend when I come again, I'll repay you. And Jesus asked the young man, so which of these 3 do you think was neighbor to him who fell among thieves? And he said, he who showed mercy on him. And Jesus said to him, gave him a big long lecture, told him how bad he was, and straightened up. No, he didn't do any of that. It's not what it says. This is what he said to the young man. Go and do likewise. 4 words. 4 life-changing words. Go and do likewise. This is what we're called to. This is what's going to make a difference in the world. Not hiding behind religiosity. Not saying some niceties. Oh, believe in Jesus. He'll bless you. And then turning and getting away before we get involved. But being willing to be there for a person, to help a person, that's loving a person like Christ. This simple parable, this simple truth can and will change the world as we yield to Christ in our lives. In the book of Mark, chapter 10 also, in verse 42, Jesus called his disciples to him and said, "You know those who are considered rulers over the Gentiles, lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them." That's the way of the world, he's saying. Ruling it over other people. We see it in the job place. Bosses that are unfair, seemingly unusually harsh, getting flack from those above them and giving it to the ones, those down below. And then people want to have their own little spheres of influence, and they want to be the ones that be in the control, lording it over the others. "Yet it shall not be so among you," he said, "but whoever desires to become great among you shall be your servant." Servant, serve. This is what Jesus came to do. He said, "And whoever of you desires to be first shall be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many." This is what it means about giving up our life. It doesn't necessarily mean being killed as a martyr, but daily yielding to God, giving over our little agendas and our little petty plans, our ideas, our wants, and letting him be in charge to use us to be vessels in his hand to be poured out into the lives of others. I'm reading a book by a man, Robert Lupton. It's called "Theirs is the Kingdom." And he and his wife felt called to leave their pleasant, simple life in the Midwest United States and travel to the inner city of Atlanta, Georgia. They felt called to minister. And he's a Christian counselor. And he said when they moved with their children to the inner city, their friends told them, "Well, you got to put your kids in private school." And they considered it. And then it hit them. Our lives aren't going to be invested in the people we come to serve if we're serving over at the private school. So they put their kids in the low-rated public school. And they got involved. And as they got involved and became enthusiastic for mentoring children and tutoring children, other parents and adults got interested, and teachers became more enthused as they saw the differences in the children, and the school performance actually improved, and it became quite a nice little school. And he writes in his book about ministering to the people he thought he came to help and teach how to live. And instead, he said he started seeing the kingdom that was already there in urban America, in the decaying inner cities, amongst people who had little, who subsisted on less than we can even imagine. And he said, "When I'm honest with myself, I must admit that I cannot fully care for one who is suffering without entering into his pain. The sick must be touched if they are to be healed. The weak must be nourished, the wounded embraced. Care is the bigger part of cure." He saw the difference in people's lives when they trusted in Christ, and that the least amongst the people he went to serve ended up with the most. Because they received the inner joy of trusting God, even though man had failed them over and over. Those that had put their trust in the government found that it wasn't so easy to get all that free stuff that they thought. That, you know, you think people have this idea, oh, people on welfare and food stamps, they just go get their stuff. But when a single mother with four kids has to go sit in line or sit in front of a social worker time and time again to get just enough, barely, almost enough money to get some food or some stamps, but the light bill's going to be cut off, that person has nowhere really to turn but to God. And he saw the poorest, most deprived person would share the little that they had with somebody that was needy. And what he had to overcome, and what many people in the caring professions have to overcome, and what the church, he said, has to overcome, is this idea that we just refer people away. Come in to get some help, and oh, I can't be bothered with that. Here, let me give you a phone number. Here, go see so-and-so. Poor African-American man came in, hadn't eaten in 3 or 4 days, came into the church. For the free meal that they had once a week, but it was the wrong day. And he saw this man being referred to a church. Go to St. Anthony's over there about 6 blocks away. I think they're free meals today. And the man left, dejected, hungry as ever. That's not serving. What the Good Samaritan did, that serving, maybe reaching into our own pocket, maybe investing our own time, maybe give ourselves, skipping an appointment or a luncheon we had and giving somebody a ride. Whatever it is that God calls us to, if we're spending time with God, he's going to lead us in it. He will lead us. There's been times when I've gotten clearly from God, don't get involved. I don't know why. Maybe God was dealing with them in a different way. Maybe God had somebody else in mind to help. Maybe it would be dangerous for me to get involved. But when God says don't get involved, then that's a different story. But there's times when you hear that still small voice. They need help. I know you guys don't have the bulletins, but I'm going to run through the outline anyway, just to recap. Jesus spent his earthly life sharing God's love and meeting needs, modeling a plan for his followers. The young lawyer had knowledge of the law, yet up until this point, he was spiritually immature. He wanted to justify himself, it says in Scripture. A lot of religious people you'll run into spend a lot of time justifying themselves by spouting out all the verses and knowledge. They try to show you how justified they are. Spiritually mature people that I've known, that I consider really spiritually mature, sometimes have a lot less to say. But when they do, I find it's really worth listening. The two religious men refused to get involved, having no compassion in their hearts. But the Samaritan gave of his time, energy, and finances to provide help and comfort for the wounded man. In your time alone, I would suggest rereading Luke 10:27. And then ponder this question: how did the Samaritan demonstrate fulfilling this verse? Where was the Samaritan's focus? And lastly, a question that will probably require some quiet time with God. Ask yourself this, and then ask God, who has God called me to love? Father God, we come before you this morning, Lord, to worship you, to praise you, to celebrate your Son Jesus and the difference that he makes in our lives today. And Father, give us the courage to step out of our comfort zone, to get involved as your Spirit leads us, Lord, to be the salt in this earth today, to make the difference, to be willing to love people where they're at, to love them first, and then to help as you lead us in helping them and loving them intelligently. We thank you, Father, for sending your Son to teach us and to model the way, the truth, and the life that we are to live and that we are to be. In his precious name we pray. Amen. I believe communion is being set up right over here by Kat and Doug under the Budweiser tent. And a friendly reminder, when we're done, if we can have the cars taken out as soon as church is over, because we're going to have folks pouring in here. Thank you.
Our first communion hymn is number 64, How Great Is Our God.
Rejoice.
Number 151, Wonderful, Merciful Savior.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls.
Number 37, I am a friend of God.
That you are mindful of me, that you hear me when I call. Is it true that you are thinking of me, how you love me? God. Lord of glory. You have called me friend, God Almighty, Lord of glory. You have called me friend, God Almighty, Lord of glory.
Have a wonderful Sunday. God bless Hog Wild.